Welcome. Sorry about that. We took slightly longer. We don't sing on a repetitive. But we are trying to move on with the times a bit so that there might be some recordings for those who are not here. And welcome. If you're coming for the first time, welcome. If you haven't been here for a few months, welcome too. And should I say goeiemôre also? Should I say sanibonani? Should I say absheni? You've all been welcomed. Please, this morning, we are continuing in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We are continuing in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. First Corinthians chapter 15, in essence, Paul addresses this whole issue about why we must believe that we will receive a resurrection body. Why should any believer know and believe that they will be resurrected from the grave? Just for those who are not here, Paul addresses this whole issue first and dealing with that. He deals with that the resurrection is an account of the gospel, which is verses 1 to 11. That the resurrection is central, it's key to the gospel. What is the gospel? The gospel is that Jesus died, Jesus was buried, and Jesus rose on the third day. So Jesus was resurrected on the third day. Now within Corinth, there were those who were holding on or who had brought in this understanding that there is no resurrection of the dead. And that's why then Paul addresses this whole issue about if the resurrection is not true, if there might not be the resurrection, then that's why in verse 12, and therefore this Jesus who's proclaimed as risen from the dead has not been raised too. And if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, it's got a whole lot of implications. And what are the implications? It means that whoever comes and stands, that's the apostles, when they come witnessing and telling them about a Christ who has been risen from the dead, that preaching is not true, it's in vain. But it's not only that preaching in vain. Whoever has believed that Jesus was raised from the dead, their faith is in vain. It's not true. But not only that, those who are preaching are lying. They are misrepresenting what God has said. And then if you believe that, it means your faith, if it's futile, it means that your sins are not forgiven. So the truth about the resurrection is true, is the truth that we need to understand that. If Jesus, and indeed Jesus was raised from the dead, it means there is forgiveness of sins for any sinner. And for those, Paul continues to say, if they had believed this resurrection, and they have died, it means they have died without hope and they have truly perished. And that's why he says they are to be pitied. But then in verse 20, he flips and says, you cannot hold on to this understanding that there is no resurrection because the resurrection is true. And if the resurrection is true, therefore Jesus was raised from the dead and therefore he is the prototype. He is the first fruits of all those who will subsequently be raised from the dead. And because he is the first fruit, it means then that when Jesus comes, he will come for his own. And because of that, then it means that the end will come once Christ has raised. But before, when he has come, he says then, he must then still overcome or rule or have triumph over all his enemies. And one of the enemies that he still needs to destroy is death, as we shall learn this morning. So all the enemies of God must be overcome. And they will be overcome. Why? Because Jesus has been raised from the dead, and we call him what? Lord. And there's implication for holding on to the truth. And he says that's why then you can then be able to do your ministry, having no issues, because you're not worried about your death, because you will be resurrected. And last week we looked at these points. To look into this understanding, if you are going to be raised from the dead, and the acknowledgement being, we know that whoever is buried, their body will decay. I said last week, must go front. But then the issue is, if your body has gone into the grave, what kind of body? What is the nature of the body that you are going to receive when Christ raises you from the dead? And we looked into that. Paul used an analogy of a seed. He said, understand that you and I don't have power over seeds. We just plant them. And that transformation process, there is a work of God of which none of us have got power. And he says it's the same also. And what type of body are you going to have? He says, the nature of your body is going to be totally different from the body that you are having now. But the truth being, you must still have a body. And the point that was clear was, only those who are Christians will be resurrected to be with Christ. We will deal also today with those who are not Christians. What's going to happen to you when those who believe in Christ are resurrected? And then he addressed those two questions. How? What is the nature of the body? And how is this? What is the manner? And then in verses 45 to 49, he dealt with the manner of body that you are going to have. He says your body in its nature, in its being, is going to be different. Because you are going to have a body like Jesus's after his resurrection. But not only will you have a body, and he says the resurrection, according to verse, the order of the resurrection is also going to follow as how then it came with Adam. And then he also understood that you need to understand your body is not going to be like the nature of the body that you have now. Because your body is not the kind of body that you're going to receive will be different from the one that you are having now. Because it must be not only a spiritual body, but it must also be a body that is eternal. And then when we closed last week, we looked as that the type of body, the archetype, the order, the pilot of the body, is you must just look into Christ. The type of body that Christ had after the resurrection is the body that you are looking forward to. That's why we have titled the message that why every believer must anticipate their resurrection body. You will have a resurrection body. With that having been said, look with me as I read with you from verses 50 to verses 58. So I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal body puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Verse 55. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that the Lord, that in the Lord your labor is in vain. Why must you have an eternal body? Why must you have a resurrection body? We will address this question. Why must you have a resurrection body? One, because you need the resurrection body for the eternal kingdom. We will address the point in verses 51 to 53. Why must you have an eternal body? Why must you have the resurrection body or the glorified body? Because you need it for the eternal kingdom. That's verses 51 to 53. You must have the eternal body. You must have the resurrection body. According to verses 54 to 56. Because at its consummation, death is going to be destroyed. When you receive the resurrection body, death is going to be destroyed. And verses 57 to 58, God is going to be glorified, and you will find joy when you receive the resurrection body. And lastly, because you have a resurrection body, you must now serve. Because you are looking forward to the resurrection body, you must serve. You must serve. Let's look at the first point. You need the resurrection body for the eternal kingdom. Look with me. He says, I tell you this, brothers. What is Paul bringing across? He's saying, what he's stating is as clear as possible that he's speaking in his authority as an apostle. But even though he's still speaking to them, he's saying, I am emphasizing this. This is my assertion to you. And when he says this, he says this and nothing else. And then what does he call them? He calls them what? Brothers. Though that I have the apostolic authority, yet between you and I, we what? We're still brothers. But why are we brothers? Because you and I believe in the truth of the body, of the resurrection body that we are going to share together. Not each one, but we believe the truth. And what he's saying to them, he says, not only do you do this, but I want you to realize this. When he says, I tell you, it's in the present tense. So this is something that you need to always holding on to. It's not a once off. It is something that you continuously need to live with the truth. And what is this truth to his brethren? He says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. When he speaks about flesh and blood, he's saying, this is the truth. This is my assertion that your natural body that you were born with, that you were given when you were born, he says, it cannot, it has no ability to inherit the eternal kingdom of God. You can't. For you to go into the eternal kingdom, you need the resurrection body. You need the terrified body. Because in your current state, you cannot enter it. And when he speaks about cannot inherit, if you are Jewish, you can't miss this understanding. That's what we are reading about this morning in the book of Leviticus. That if you are Jewish and you were not part of the Levitical priesthood, what would happen to you? You were allocated a portion of land. So he's saying, when you go and have your allocation in the eternal kingdom, you need the eternal. You need the resurrection body. But I need for you to understand that there are various ideas about when you read in the Bible, when it talks about the kingdom of God. You need to know when sometimes when you're reading, it talks about, when it talks about the kingdom, it talks about the universal kingdom of God, where it means God rules and reigns as king. Or when it speaks about that issue of the kingdom of God, it talks about the spiritual kingdom, the one where Christ speaks and he says, I've come to declare the kingdom of God. But this is the kind of kingdom where God as a ruler rules over believers only. And when it speaks again in the Bible, when he speaks about the kingdom of God, it speaks about the theocratic, where God himself has rulership over all kingdoms of the earth. That's the kingdom of God. That kind of kingdom is that kingdom that is universal, that is pointing to you and I in the book of Daniel. One of the truths about the book of Daniel is for you to understand that God's kingdom is above all kingdoms, all human kingdoms. All. They will come, they will go, but God's kingdom will continue. And that is a key truth for anyone who's a Christian. What is the most important thing in your life? That you belong to the kingdom of God. That's what must drive what your values are. Because you belong to a kingdom without beginning and a kingdom without end. But that was the third one. The fourth one is this one where Christ spoke about the mysterious kingdom that will be ushered in. And the fifth is what we call the millennial kingdom. That is also the kingdom of God. The millennial kingdom is this kingdom where Christ must come and reign on the earth for 1,000 years. And he still must come. Because remember the promise, the covenant that was made to David. He said, God said to David, he must have a son who must sit on his throne and rule for when? Forever. When Christ first came, which kingdom did he rule over? He did not rule over Israel. That's why he was rejected. But according to the covenant that God made, Christ must still come back. And that's what we know. When we study the scriptures in Revelation and we've looked at it in this church, right, in passing, that Christ is going to come and reign on this earth for 1,000 years. Because that will be the only time where the world will experience a true king, a true righteous king without sin ruling over people. And so when I speak now, and I'm saying when you look into our text, and he says you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. He's not talking about those five kingdoms. He's talking about the eternal kingdom. The kingdom that's going to come at the consummation of the age. You can read about it in Revelation, from Revelation 21. Where Christ now rules forever. But for anyone to go into that kingdom, what do they need? A resurrection body. Look with me again in the text. He says, not only will flesh and blood not inherit the kingdom of God, he says, nor does the perishable. He says, understand this. Totally rule this thing. When you use the word no, totally rule this idea out of your mind. Dismiss this idea totally that flesh and blood will go into the kingdom. That's why he says, Nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. We looked at what is perishable last week. We said, what is perishable? It is that one that is subject to ruin. Anything that is subject to decay. What do we know about our bodies once we die? They're going to perish. Oh, see, there are more young people than last week here. We said, when we grow, what do we know about ourselves? Our bodies are decaying. We are in a state of decay. That's why you don't look like 10 years ago. And when you are 50, you don't look like 50 years ago. And when you are 80, you don't look like 80 years ago. What you have seen is the state of gradual decay. And he says, what you must be clear in our minds is this. This body that is perishable cannot inherit what is imperishable. And we said, what is imperishable? It is that one that is not subject to decay. Because in the eternal kingdom, nothing will. So what is the point that Paul is trying to say to us in verse 50? He's saying nothing else. You need a totally transformed body for the eternal state. But not only do you need it, but then the question must come. But yes, Paul, you are now addressing those who are dead. What about those who at the time of the coming of Christ, what's going to happen to them? Look with me when he answers, he says, behold, here is a glorious truth. And what does he say? He says, behold, I tell you a mystery. And a mystery, when Paul talks about the biblical mystery, is a truth that had not been revealed before, but yes, it's now known. He says, here is a true mystery, a glorious truth. And I want you to realize something. He says, as part of dismissing this, he says, we shall not all sleep. That word sleep, it's a euphemism for dying. Because Christians don't sleep. They are just what? They don't die. They are just sleeping. Because what's going to happen to them? They must still be raised. That's why dying is not a totality. But let's go back. He says, we shall not all sleep. He's saying there will be an exception to those, right? And I want you to realize, he says, in the eternal kingdom, those who are alive also cannot enter it in those bodies. But there's this thought that Paul wants you to see. He says, we shall not all sleep, holding on to this idea that even whilst he was still alive, he held on to this imminent return of Christ. He lived with the thought that Christ could come. But where does he get this? About this return of Christ. Go with me to the book of John. John chapter 14. Christ, as he speaks to his disciples, they are worried. He's told them that he's going. And because they are human beings, he has to give them an assurance. He says, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would not have told you. This is the assurance. He's giving them a promise. If it were not so, I would not have told you. I go prepare a place for you. But look at the key, verse 3. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, that you may also be. So the disciples, as they were living, as Christ lived, they always lived with this imminent idea, that the notion that Christ could return at any moment. You're going to say, that's Paul. Why is Paul saying this? Go with me again in the book of Corinthians chapter 1. Let's look at verse 7 quickly. We'll start at verse 4 for context. Just go to chapter 1, 1 Corinthians, just chapter 1. We're going to read verse 7, but we just give you context. He says, I give thanks to my God always for you. Why? Because of the grace of God. What happened? That was given to you where? In Christ Jesus. Why? That any way, that in every way you were enriched in him, in all speech and knowledge. He says, you were given all the giftings that are there by the grace of God in totality. To what extent? Even as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you. He says, you know this. But look at verse 7. So that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Even from chapter 1, he is telling the Corinthian church that they are waiting for Christ's imminent return. But again, you'll say, where is this thought? You know, look with me to the first letter, the very first letter that Paul ever wrote, the earliest letter of Paul. And if you don't know, that's the book of Thessalonians. Don't look at it in terms of where it is in the Bible, but that's the first letter that Paul wrote. And by the way, if you don't recall, you can read it in the book of Acts. Paul was not long and didn't stay long. He was chased out of the place in Thessalonica. But even in that time, he had told them these truths. Look what happened in verse 9. Or we can start in verse 8 for context. This is what was happening in the church in Thessalonica. He says, for not only has the word of the Lord sounded forth from you in Macedonia and Achaia, but your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, so that we have not need to say anything. What is this? This is a productive church. This is a church that serves. After it had received the message, it was going out and proclaiming about how people need to be saved from their sins through Christ. But look at this in verse 9. For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. That's what every believer needs to know, that when you came to God, before then, who are you serving? Idols. And who's the greatest idol that you are serving? Yourself. But for you to become a believer, you must turn from serving your idols. And who must you turn? Because idols are what? If you are serving a living and a true God, what happens to your idols? What are they? They are dead. They don't have power. But look at verse 10. And to wait for his son from heaven. What are you telling them? That the coming, the return is imminent. Hold on to this idea. That's why I'm not saying that he's coming soon. Because if you talk about soon, you are implying before long or shortly. That's why it is imminent. You don't know the day, you don't know the time, but you are expecting his return. Let's go back to the book of Corinthians again. So Paul says, we shall not all sleep. Do you see the transition? But we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. So Paul says there is going to be this time where believers who are on earth, Christ will come. And when it comes, it's going to happen in a moment. He says there will be a transformation. But realize, he says, in this changing, that we're changing, the idea is changing one thing for another. It's talking about movement. And when he says in a moment, it's moment is a time. It's time that you can't divide. That's why he says it's in a twinkling of an eye. That's how it's going to happen. And then he talks about this whole issue that there's going to be a trumpet. But where is he getting all of these ideas? Look with me in the book of Thessalonians again, chapter 4. He's talking now about the rapture. What's going to happen at the time when Christ comes for the church? Those who are in the church. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And remember I said this is the first book that Paul wrote. The first letter. And these people were not long with Paul. They'd with him for a short time. But they knew these truths. Let's read from verse 13, but I know where I want to go. Again, he says, we do not want you to be uninformed. What is he saying? We want you to have knowledge. We don't want you to walk around ignorantly, not knowing. You must know these. What must you know? About those who are asleep. About those who have died. This is what you need to know. That you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. Those who die in Christ, those who are left behind, should not grieve as if there is no hope for them. Then who doesn't have hope? Who doesn't have hope? Those who are dead and did not sleep. Because those who sleep, only those who belong to Christ. Don't forget. Yeah. And those who are asleep have hope. Because that is a future expectation of good that's going to come. That's the hope. It's a future expectation of the good that's going to come. Why? For since we believe that Jesus died. He says, this is a certainty. We believe. We hold on to it. We continue in that. That Jesus died. And what happened? And he rose again. He was resurrected. To what extent? Even so, though through Jesus is the means, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. The same Jesus, the way that Christ was raised, God says, those who believed in him. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord that we who are alive, that's the idea. We who are alive, what is the idea? Imminent again. Imminency. We who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will precede those who have fallen asleep. Oh, sorry. Will not. What does it mean? Precede means comes before. Will not precede those who have fallen asleep. Meaning, those who have died will do what? Will have order of preference. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command. Three things. With a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Who is going to be resurrected first? Those who died. That's why they must precede those who are alive. Look again, verse 7. What's the result? What's the fourth? Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So we will always be with the Lord. That's why it says, in a twinkling. In a moment, that's what's going to happen. When Christ comes, this is not talking about the second coming. This is not where Jesus is back on earth. He is only coming to rapture and take who? Those who are dead in Christ, those who are in the church. So there's going to be a moment where the church is no longer existing on the earth. No church. And at that time, those who knew you to be a Christian will know what has happened. And if you are busy playing church, we'll ask you, they are all gone. Why are you still here? Why are you here? Because he has taken those who belong to him. Even those who are dead, they are not forgotten. That's why he told us, and he says what? Therefore, encourage one another. This is a text that encourages believers regarding what is going to happen to those who have died and even to themselves. Let's go back to our text again. Let's go back to Corinthians. Hey, time is on my heels, man. Time is on my heels. And what verse am I on? Sorry, I'm reading the wrong text. 1 Corinthians 15, right? And then it says, and he speaks about the last trumpet. He says, as he continues, the continuation of the idea about the last trumpet. He says, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. What is he saying? He says, even for those who are alive, whether dead or alive, you all need a change of body. You all need a resurrection body. You all need the glorified body, the same body. And when he speaks about the last trumpet, you must not forget, it comes here from the ideas from the book of Exodus. When the children of Israel were called to come and assemble, what must happen? The trumpet must sound and they must all come and gather. So the last trumpet will sound and those who are Christ will come. And believe you me, the rest of you all will hear it. You'll hear it. So what you must see from verse 51 is the body is changed. It is not deployed. It is not destroyed. And because the body is changed, it is not replaced. Same body changed, not destroyed. So what it means is it says, it speaks about, we need to ask ourselves, then what happens between now and then? What happens between now and then? What happens to you when you die today? The Bible speaks about there's going to be this intermediate state where your body must still rest in the grave. But what has happened to your soul, it must go up to heaven. But you're going to say, but how do you, we can look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, or we can go to the book of Revelation. If I'm not mistaken, it must be Revelation 6. The book of Revelation. Remember that book that we are afraid of. Am I in the right chapter? You know, when I go to these ones where I didn't write it down. Let's look at verse 9. Verse 9 of Revelation 6. This is the fifth seal. There's these different seals. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. These are the martyrs, those who have died. They cried out with a loud voice. Where are they? They are in heaven. O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before will you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? The idea is death is not permanent. It's just a transition. Those who have died in Christ, in their soul, they are in heaven. And what they still see. Do you see that? They can see the earth.
So it's not as if you have gone, you have disappeared, you have vanished. No! It's not! And look at this. Then they were each given a white robe and told. So where are they going to put a robe? You need somebody for that. But it is not your body. This is now your soul. Your immaterial component. This is where you are in heaven with Christ.
But you need a body, a resurrection body, to go into the eternal state. The same idea is in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. You'll read it at home. I think from around verse 6. Where Paul talks about how he longs to be with Christ. That's the idea. Let's go back to our text. Now you'll ask me. But that's the believers. What happened to unbelievers? If you're an unbeliever, you die. You're also going into the intermediate state. The place that is called Hades. You can read it in the book of Revelation. I'm looking at my time. And what it says, you're going to wait there until your day of judgment. And on your day of judgment, you're going to be raised. So it changes. When you are raised, you must be raised in a body. Your body. It's not a transformed body. Because God still has the power. Or people will say, maybe we'll come back again next week and deal with the rest. Let's go to Revelation chapter 20. Verse 11. Because before then, remember I told you about the 1,000-year reign of Christ. You can look it up in verses 4 to 11. That's what you're going to get about Christ who must reign for 1,000 years. But look at verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne. This is the great white throne judgment. This is for all unbelievers who must stand before Christ, the judge, rather than Christ, the Savior. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The one who sits means he knows works anymore. What is his work now? He's judging. From his presence, earth and sky fell away, and no place was found for them. Verse 12. And I saw the great dead, great and small. It doesn't matter your economic status. It doesn't matter where you fit in, whether you are a king or a lowly peasant. Just as long as you have not believed in Christ, you must then come and stand before Christ. You, yourself. Personally, individually. I said no groups. No groups. Individual. You must come. And he says books were open. And then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. Oh, but I died in the sea. My body dissolved. Look at verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged individually, each one of them. On what basis? What is the basis of the judgment for everyone who will stand before Christ? Look at the text. It tells you what is the basis. According to what they had done. All your deeds will stand before God. Remember this idea? It's there in Romans 2. Remember how God will judge all men according to their deeds. Romans 2. Even unbelievers, your deeds will stand and account to God for them. And then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death. You die the first death, and you must still come and die the second death. And what happens to those who believe in Christ? You will not die the second death. You'll only die once. Let's go back to our text. The book of Thessalonians, the book of Corinthians. And it says the trumpet will sound. And the dead will be raised. And he says, when the dead will be raised, he says, this is a fact. Know that. Future.
When the trumpet rises, it says, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. This is why he says, now your imperishable body, this one that is decaying, change, transform. And look at verse 3. Why? Why do you hold on? Why? He says, for this perishable. When he says this, please don't miss this. And not any other. When you say the word, and this body, says, and not any other body. And for this perishable body, must put on the perishable. And this mortal body, must put on immortality. How many times do you see the must? Twice. That's a divine imperative. Must. It's a necessity that the body be transformed. If he says must, he says it is not an elective. It is not a choice. For you to go into the eternal state, your body must. We looked at those ideas last week about what do we mean by mortal? What do we mean by imperishable? But you see, when it is mortal, we said it's subject to death. So this body that is subject to death, the mortal one, must be changed to the one that is immortal. Meaning, literally, without death. At the time, there is a transformed body. Time is not on my side. Don't want to keep you for long. We'll come back next week. We will deal with this idea about what's going to happen to death. Because death must still be defeated. You must still know again that after death, what does it mean for you? Why do you thank God for the fact that death has now been destroyed? And how? Because you know that you no longer fear death. You can serve God. Serve God with everything that you have in you. Because Paul said it's not in vain. So let's talk to us. We must believe this truth. We must believe this truth that you need the resurrection body to get into the eternal kingdom. It doesn't matter whether, as Paul says, whether you are dead or even when you are alive, you need a new transformed body. And we said, this body is not the body that you are currently having. It's a totally new body. And once you have this body, that's why you have this hope that you can live this life. Always looking forward to the fact that you will receive the resurrection body. That's what gives you hope as you and I continue to walk in this earth. Because we look forward to our resurrection body. We thank you, Father. We bless you this morning. We glorify you and honor you. That these truths we hold eternal. That indeed we are those people who have hope, for we have known what God has done for us. And the promises that are true even to our lives. And we look forward to that time where we shall receive those new bodies. But in our current state, we'll continue to love and to serve you. And to serve your people. And to tell others these truths that they themselves must believe in the resurrection of Christ. For it is the only means that gives hope to us. And for this we thank you. We praise you and glorify you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.